Are there any questions? Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. My question's to the Minister for Health. Victoria is on track to reach its 70% vaccination target earlier than the state government roadmap forecasts. Is the government taking advice on how it might relax restrictions accordingly earlier?
I call the Minister for Health.
Can I thank the Leader of the Opposition for his question? And that does give me an opportunity to just reflect on the extraordinary efforts that Victorians right across the board have come forward in recent times to power through our vaccination rates as we seek to deliver on the national plan to reopen through the Victorian roadmap. Victorian roadmap indicated indicative dates as to when, at the time of the release of that roadmap, that we saw the state reaching the benchmarks of the 70 and 80% double dose marks that were set out in the national plan. Now that we are some 10 months after the launch of the Commonwealth's vaccine program, have enough certainty and availability and points of supply of vaccines across the state, I am confident that the support from the Victorian community will allow us to meet those benchmarks. And many pundits, including those who advise the Chief Health Officer, have indicated that given the extraordinary manner in which Victorians have come forward to get vaccinated, that there is every prospect that those indicative dates may be improved on. In regards to what that then means, the process that we have in place is careful, measured and sustainable. There are some that would argue that you simply throw the doors open and that you, in so doing, run the risk of crushing our public health system in so doing. That is not a position that the Victorian government will follow. The Victorian government will take the public health advice, will deliver the national plan for reopening, and will deliver on the roadmap as set out publicly. It does also give me the opportunity to just briefly reflect on some announcements that the government made in regards to ensuring that we deliver as fast as we possibly can the roadmap for the delivery of the national plan to reopen. Today, we rolled out further essentially mini pop-ups to reflect on the fact that we are now in a position to drive down to the neighbourhood level vaccination programs in those high-risk communities that have, are now, quite frankly, powering towards meeting, if not exceeding, the state average of vaccine programs. So whether it's in your local communities, whether it's in your Degani's coffee shop, whether it's at Foundation House for asylum seekers and refugees, whether it's at community health centres, whether it's literally at pop-ups in local strip shopping centres, Victorians are backing the plan to get vaccinated.
The Leader of the Opposition on a supplementary question.
On supplementary, I ask if Victorians' mental and physical health has suffered immensely under the longest lockdowns in the world, will the Minister now commit to bringing forward the opening of the fitness and health industry indoors, including gyms at 70% fully vaccinated, in line with New South Wales?
Minister for Health.
So the Honourable Member draws comparison with New South Wales as the core of his question. And we wish New South Wales every success in their efforts. But that's like comparing apples and oranges in many ways. Because, of course, there is some more than 1 million extra vaccines have been provided to New South Wales, disproportionately Pfizer vaccines, as a result of the active redistribution from Victorian primary care into New South Wales primary care by the Commonwealth Government. And good luck to New South Wales. They did have that outbreak starting with that unmasked and unvaccinated limousine and bus driver, which then saw the wave spread throughout New South Wales, throughout the ACT, and sadly into Victoria, and of course in New Zealand. But of course, as a result of that, we do not begrudge from our rollout of our
answer has
plan.
Concluded. Order. The Premier on a Minister's statement.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I'm delighted to rise to update the House that today we're able to report that 38,072 vaccines were administered yesterday in state hubs. That's a very significant day's work, and beyond that, there were obviously tens of thousands of other doses administered in primary care. Community pharmacy done a fantastic job, and our partnership with the Guild is a very, very strong one. GP practices and our partnership with the College, as well as the AMA, to provide grants to support both pharmacy and GPs to be open more hours, to employ more staff, to do more of their important work. That's paying dividends as well. Because you see, Speaker, we now have over 4 million total doses out of state-run clinics and a total across Victoria of some 8.2 million doses. We have vaccinated record numbers in record time. And that is something that every Victorian who has been vaccinated and all of those who've been working in that vaccination program, both state hubs as well as GP practices and community pharmacy, they should be very proud of the work that they've done. I'm certainly very proud of them and very grateful, Mr. Speaker, that we've seen such significant numbers of people vaccinated. 87.1% of the 16 plus population are vaccinated at least one dose, so we're closing in on 90% single dose, and 60.9% are fully dosed with two shots. Over the coming weeks, as the Minister just referred to, we will have pop-ups, neighbourhood pop-ups, literally going door to door, taking the program to the local community, particularly in those areas where the vaccination rate is perhaps not as high as we would like. This program has been a success. We are pleased to have played roughly double the role that we thought we would have to play, roughly double the role that we signed up to. And I see questions about New South Wales. You know, to be less than a fortnight behind New South Wales, maybe only 9 or 10 or 11 days behind New South Wales, without the inside running on vaccine supply that New South Wales got, is a credit to all Victorians. A credit to all Victorians.
Order. Order. On a question, order. Leader of the Nationals on a question.
Speaker, my question is to the Minister for Health. As of Monday, regional Victoria is 7 percentage points above metropolitan Melbourne fully vaccinated rate. Will the government allow regional Victoria their freedoms earlier if they meet the national cabinet targets earlier than metropolitan Melbourne?
Order, order. Members will come to order. Minister for Health has a call.
So can I thank the Leader of the Nationals for his question? He seems to predicate his question, I think in good faith, on the basis that it adequately reflects the position of the National Plan to reopen. I would refer the Honourable Member to that National Plan, which does not, in fact, support the contention that he's made. What the National Plan talks about from its earliest iteration is that states would proceed as an overall group, and that the nation would proceed as an overall group.
That's right.
There is no allowance in the National Plan for the dividing up of how different arrangements would apply in delivering the National Plan. But of course, we already have a position in Victoria where large areas of Victoria, particularly in our regions, are under significantly less restrictions in Victoria than metropolitan Melbourne. Indeed, only this morning we announced that Mitchell Shire, right on the peri-urban borders of the metropolitan area in the Goulburn catchment, were moving as of 11:59pm tonight into a lesser restricted area as a result of the great efforts of vaccination and bringing under control their particular current outbreaks. So in regards to the general proposition that the Honourable Member predicts his question, I think he needs to refer back to both the
order.
National Plan,
just ask the Minister to its resume basis. His seat. Order. I just ask the Minister to resume his seat. A point of order, Leader of the Nationals.
Speaker, on the issue of relevance.
Order. Order. Without the assistance of the Leader of the House. Order. Order.
On the issue of relevance, Speaker, the question
leader
was very clear. Will the government allow regional Victoria their 70% freedoms if we meet the target earlier than Melbourne? And I ask you to bring him back to actually answering that issue about regional Victoria getting their freedoms earlier if they meet the targets.
Order. The Minister's being relevant to the question that's been asked. The Minister.
So, again, I think the Honourable Member's a point of order just reflects a fundamental misunderstanding of what the National Plan says, and indeed what the Victorian Roadmap to deliver the National Plan says. The National Plan to transition to Australia's national COVID-19 response, a very significant document that the Prime Minister launched, is predicated on how states go about delivering the gateways of 70 and 80% double dose. And indeed, I suspect states won't stop at 80% double dose. What the Honourable Member is inviting Victorians to do is to depart from that national plan, which we won't be doing. But can I also take this opportunity to thank regional Victorians who have come out in great numbers to be vaccinated. Indeed, some of the highest vaccine rates in the country have been achieved by regional Victorians. But it's not uniform, and it is not across the board, as the Honourable Member knows. So that is why we need to, as a state, and as local government areas, run down all the way to the wire of 70 and 80% double dose, and indeed beyond, as we make sure that we look to Christmas and we look to 2022 with a greater sense of optimism.
Supplementary question, Leader National.
Yes, I have. If the Minister, if the government won't allow regional Victoria to move ahead of metropolitan Melbourne in the roadmap, given their higher vaccination rates, Minister at least allow regional Victorians to take off their masks outdoors when social distancing can be maintained?
Call the Minister for Health.
Again, the Honourable Member, I thank the Honourable Member for his supplementary question, but the Honourable Member again misrepresents the current position as well as a misunderstanding of both the National Plan and the rollout of the state roadmap to deliver. Regional Victoria is largely in a much better position than metropolitan Melbourne when it comes to levels of restrictions. So the notion that regional Victoria is being held back by metropolitan Melbourne restrictions is one that I refute. As we know that regional Victorians who have worked so hard to protect that status...
Order, the point of order, Leader of Nationals.
On the issue of relevant speaker, the Minister is deliberately misrepresenting myself in the question.
Order.
The simple, very simple question. Will the Minister at least allow regional Victorians to take their masks off if social distancing can be maintained? And I particularly ask you to bring him back to answering that question on all behalf of all the regional Victorians who are just frustrated with having to wear a mask outdoors.
Leader of the Nationals, order. Leader of the Nationals knows it's not an opportunity to make a speech. Order. I don't uphold the point of order. I ask the Minister to continue answering the question.
So can I, Speaker, as I was indicating, I'd refer the Honourable Member to the roadmap to deliver the National Plan that the Victorian Government has released. That addresses those issues. It seeks to recognise and reward regional Victorians for their hard efforts to date whilst bringing the state together as a whole.
On a Minister's statement, I call the Treasurer.
Well, thanks, Speaker, and it gives me great pleasure to update the House on how the government is helping more Victorians to buy their own homes with the launch of the Victorian Home Buyer Fund. Now, Speaker, this is an outstanding innovation, and it is one that will ensure that many Victorians realise the dream of home ownership. It'll ensure that they are able to buy a safe and secure place to call their own. Speaker, the Victorian Home Buyer Fund is a shared equity arrangement where the government contributes up to 25% of the purchase price, reducing the deposit requirements for eligible participants down to 3.5% for Aboriginal Victorians and 5% for all other Victorians. The fund also will relieve Victorian home buyers from that extra financial burden associated with lenders' mortgage insurance. So this $500 million fund will support more than 3,000 Victorians to become homeowners, expanding on our successful trial of the Homes Vic pilot scheme. Speaker, we on this side of the chamber understand how important it is to Victorians that they get support in saving for a home. Unlike those opposite, the member for Brighton, for example, campaigned to close emergency housing. We're doing the hard yards to help Victorians reach their home ownership dreams. I'm pleased to say that the eligibility criteria under the fund has been broadened, as has the capacity for properties right across the various parts of the state to now be included. As a result, our banking partners are reporting that they are being inundated with inquiries about this fund. Speaker, this government knows that Victorians want good, safe places to secure as their homes. That's why we've given stamp duty free purchases to eligible first homeowners and first homeowner grants.
Call the member for Kew. Order. Leader of the House will come to order. And the Minister for Regional Development, Member for Kew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Will the Premier rule out taxpayers footing the bill for lawyers to represent Labor members of Parliament and staff who are appearing at the Anti-Corruption Commission?
I call the Premier.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and I thank the Leader of the Opposition. And yes, the question's in order because it's the same as the one he asked yesterday. The Member for Kew may not be aware, but through the VMIA, the government's insurer, there have been, for many decades, processes, precedents and practices that would have applied to, well, for instance, planning ministers in the former government, water ministers in the former government, maybe even. Water ministers, maybe? Yes. More ministers focused on perrier water than actual water, or planning ministers more interested in, really, probably more likely, better referred to as approval ministers rather than planning ministers.
Ask the Premier to resume his seat. Order. When the House comes to order, the Minister for Regional Development has already been warned. Member for Euroa and the Deputy Premier. The Member for Kew on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. On relevance, it was a very narrow question and I'd ask you to ask the Premier to answer it, please.
Ask the Premier to come back to answering the question.
Speaker, so as I was saying, there have been for many years practices and precedents and indeed a policy of the government's insurer, and it has been applied across the board, governments of all political persuasions, for all manner of different inquiries, all manner of different processes. But I would simply refer, so that's a matter of process, and I'm not here today to announce a change to that process. Secondly, I would refer the Honourable Member for Kew to the answer I provided yesterday. I am not privy to who has been called. If you want to know who has been called to IBAC or who has assisted IBAC, those questions are best directed to IBAC.
Supplementary question, the Member for Kew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Is former departmental staff member, then Labor adviser Earl Schreiber, who appeared at the Anti-Corruption Commission hearings yesterday, having her legal fees paid by the taxpayer?
Premier?
I have no idea.
Order. On a minister's statement, I call the Minister for Regional Development.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Today I rise to update the House on the work of the Andrews Labor government to create jobs across rural and regional Victoria. We continue to get on with it across rural and regional Victoria, and I'm proud to report that unemployment in regional Victoria has fallen to a record low of 3.2%. This is, of course, 3.4% lower than when the previous Liberal National government left office in 2014. So whether it's the big housing build or investing in our schools or our hospitals or building trains in Ballarat, our government is creating jobs and building vital infrastructure in every corner of the state. So regardless of whether they create 500 jobs or 50, every one of our investments has a huge impact on local communities and businesses. And indeed, being fortunate to live in the regions myself, I was able to visit Bright a couple of weeks ago, and if the member for Ovens Valley were here, I'm sure he would appreciate our investment in Bright Brewery, which Bright Brewery is bringing its canning operations in-house in order to secure its business. Now, this is a business that employs 5 apprentices, a business that is committed to growing its own staff right there in the beautiful Ovens Valley. In Mildura, 150 jobs are being created thanks to our support for the CAN Group's medicinal cannabis cultivation and processing facility, while in Portland, we're creating 75 jobs while we revitalising the foreshore. And in Lancefield, 15 new jobs are being supported by our investment in the Lost Watering Hole, whose trademark is the mythical panther. Now, the member for Murray Plains may well remember the $150,000 he wasted searching for the big black cat. Meanwhile, we're getting on with it.
Order. Member for Melbourne.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, as Victoria opens up in the coming weeks, it's likely that checking in via the Service Victoria app with QR codes will continue to be important to keep our COVID numbers low. In fact, it'll probably become even more important as it's linked to our vaccination status, allowing people to attend events, restaurants, etc. In Western Australia, the Labor government has legislated to ensure data from QR code check-in apps can only be used for contact tracing purposes and can't be accessed by the police or for any other purposes. Why have we not legislated to close this loophole here in Victoria?
The Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member for Melbourne for her question and for her interest in these issues of privacy and integrity. It's also a matter of making sure that there's not any barrier whatsoever to people participating in the vaccinated economy as fully vaccinated Victorians. You have to have confidence in the systems that have been built. Now, so I don't disagree that these are important matters, and the government will have more to say in these areas at a time of our choosing. I would just say in broader terms, though, I want to commend the Minister for Government Services and the Assistant Treasurer, who are working across the aisle and across the Murray with his New South Wales counterpart, Minister Victor Dominello, as well as with Minister Robert representing the National Government. There have been nation-leading investments, cooperation, partnership, all sorts of work that's gone on to make sure that we've got a technology solution that hopefully between Victoria and New South Wales can be seamless. Our governments are talking. These are matters that I've been discussing, issues of New South Wales-Victoria partnership and important cooperation with Premier Perrottet as recently as last Saturday. On the issue of QR, there are and access to data, there's currently a process where the only way that data can be accessed is via an application and the order of a court. We believe that that is appropriate. Whether we might go further, I would simply, with respect, put it to the member for Melbourne that that's a matter for the government to consider. There are many matters that we're currently considering, but I wouldn't want anyone in reading my answer or listening to my answer to in any way feel that issues of data security and integrity and the safety of this system has not at all times been front of mind, as well as the primary and most important issue for the capturing of this data is for the protection of public health. No other reason. That's why police, for instance, don't get that data as of right. They have to go to a court and demonstrate and satisfy a magistrate or, in fact, a judge that they need that, that it is on a very high test, something that they ought to have access to. Now, can we go further? Can we make further changes? Well, again, I'm not here to make those announcements today, but we are considering all sorts of different issues. But we've built this. Victorians are responding. The trials that are going on, I think, in 14 different venues and events across regional Victoria are proof positive that this vaccinated economy can work. The work that's going on in New South Wales that we're directly plugged into, again, evidence that this can work and that it will work. And the Victorians who, on millions and millions, perhaps tens of millions of occasions, who have checked in, they're voting with their feet They're showing their confidence in this system, and they know that this is how we will keep ourselves open and safe.
Member for Melbourne on a supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank the Premier for his answer. The Premier mentioned that confidence in the system is the most important thing, and we know that people in Victoria want to do the right thing. They want to keep checking in to keep each other safe, and that the people of Victoria have put a lot of trust in their government over the last 2 years. But people have told me, constituents, that they're worried that they might stop using the app altogether because they're worried that the police or other agencies might be able to access the data, even if they first have to get a warrant. Now, these are people who have been very compliant with restrictions to date, and that worries me because I think it might be a sentiment that's shared broadly by quite reasonable people. So doesn't it make sense just to legislate, as WA has done, to ensure QR code data is only for contact tracing purposes, rather than leaving a loophole that could undermine people's trust in the system?
Premier.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank the member for Melbourne for her supplementary question. And I would just say that the circumstances in WA and the circumstances in Victoria are very, very different. They are running a COVID zero strategy where every check-in is important, don't misunderstand me, but they are in a very different epidemiological position than what Victoria is in. The second point I'd make to the honourable member, with the greatest of respect, it's absolutely appropriate to advocate positions and views, but I wouldn't want to think that anybody in the Greens were essentially trying to undermine the very confidence that they're talking about by perhaps scaring people into thinking that it's a warrant. It's not a warrant. As I'm advised, you've got to go to court. It's not something done out of session on a tick and flick basis. You've got to go to court and make the case that you ought to unlock the box and get that data,
which
has not occurred. So I wouldn't want to think for a moment that in advocating the issue, one we could agree on more broadly, the Greens are actually sowing and fermenting the very fear and lack of confidence they seem so interested in, at least on face value.
What are the Minister for Public Transport on a Minister's statement?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to update the House on how the Andrews Labor government is tackling transport emissions while at the same time creating new jobs, more manufacturing opportunities and more apprenticeships right across Victoria. Mr. Speaker, we know tackling transport emissions is imminent and so vitally important. It is the second largest source of emissions in our economy and the fastest growing. With my friend, the Minister for Climate Change and the Transport Infrastructure Minister, we are tackling transport emissions head on. We are decarbonising transport with our $100 million investment to drive down emissions. Mr. Speaker, I was very pleased recently to announce some very significant investments in our bus network. Mr. Speaker, we know buses coming out of COVID have been one of the most resilient forms of public transport. We also know that buses return $5 to the community for every dollar invested. We also know one bus has the equivalent of taking 50 cars off the street. That's why I was very pleased to release the first bus plan in 50 years on behalf of the Andrews Labor government, quickly followed up, though, by a major $2 billion investment in a third of our network that will see locally born, thriving local company Kinetic take one third of our bus transport system. Most importantly, though, with this, it really does accelerate our transition to zero emissions. And Mr. Speaker, if you don't take my word for it, take what the Electric Vehicle Council of Victoria said. They said this is a step in the right direction. Take what the Public Transport Users Association said. The shift towards electric buses is very welcome. Take what Sustainable Cities said. They said we welcome this step. It is a step in the right direction. Mr. Speaker, we are tackling transport emissions head on, while also creating more jobs, whether it's in Dandenong, whether it's in Ballarat. We're also reforming the bus network from Cranbourne right throughout the state, right up to Castlemaine. Under this investment, we're transforming transport right through the big build, but also to tackling transport emissions head on and driving investment and more innovation as well.
Member for Croydon.
It is lucky I gave it to him yesterday too. He's prepared. Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister for Education. VCE students are currently sitting their oral and performance exams. What safety measures does the government have in place to stop the spread of COVID between examiners and students in the event of a COVID positive case?
I call the Minister for Education.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I thank the
Shadow Minister for Education for his question. That is the Honourable Member's correct title, Member for Ripon. But courtesy of his leader, no responsibility for students. And that is a fact. That is a fact. I'm not sure what the purpose of education is other than supporting students and their growth and their well-being.
Point of order. Point of order, Leader of the Opposition. Order. Leader of the Opposition.
On relevant, Speaker, it's a strange segue for the Education Minister.
Order. Without the assistance of the Deputy Premier, Leader of the Opposition has the call. Deputy Premier.
It's a strange segue for the Education Minister. I think the Member for Croydon asked a very straightforward question about the safety of Victorian students. The safety of Victorian students during COVID.
The Minister for Regional Development.
The safety of Victorian students during COVID. And I wonder if the Minister could be brought back to talk about the specific question, which was the safety of Victorian students.
The Minister is to come back to answering the question.
I'm very happy to answer the question drafted by Mr. Bark in the other place, the Shadow Minister for Students. So, Speaker, there are a number of mitigation measures that we put in place to protect students and staff. The most important mitigation and our pathway through this pandemic, Speaker, is vaccination. And that's why we had a VCE vaccination blitz. A blitz responded to so well by VCE students, by VCE examiners. So the most important mitigation to the Honourable Member is our vaccination plan and our blitz, and that has delivered results. The exams, Speaker, just like the GAT, in which 85,000 students participated, the exams will be conducted in a COVID-safe way, both in terms of social distancing between students as they conduct their exams. We're working very closely with the public health team in terms of providing comfort to students and to families, if there is, during this exam period. And as the Honourable Member said, we're currently through oral and performance exams. Written exams start on the 27th of October. We're working closely with public health, and I'll have more to say within the next day or so in terms of what further support and comfort we can provide to parents and students if a student is a primary close contact as a result of a positive case during any of our exams. As I've said on a number of occasions, there is no way in a pandemic you can get to a zero risk environment. But rolling out air purifiers across all our schools, requiring staff to be vaccinated, and I again point out that those opposite had four different positions on the issue of requirement of vaccination for staff. From the Leader of the Opposition opposing it one day to supporting it the next, silence from the Shadow Minister for Education, and downright opposition from the Member for Brighton, and support, can I say, from the Shadow Minister for Health. Four different positions. We follow public health advice. We don't deny transmission in our schools, and we've got mitigation measures in place to keep our kids safe.
Member for Croydon on a supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. And noting the Minister says that he will have more to say in a few days, I'm wondering whether we might be able to entice some of that out of him sooner than later. Minister, will the government commit to using rapid testing for all students and examiners to prevent the spread of COVID?
Minister for Education.
So, in terms of RAT testing, Speaker, as the Shadow Minister should know, that does not have approval for use from the TGA until the 1st of November. Exams are already underway. What I have said in regards to rapid antigen testing, what I have said in regards to RAT testing is that in anticipation of that decision out of the TGA, we're conducting a trial, a home-based trial, with families and with students, particularly younger kids, in terms of how we can practically implement rapid testing once it's available.
On a minister's statement, I call the Minister for Energy, Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you, Speaker, and I'm absolutely delighted to update the House on the fantastic results being delivered to Victorians thanks to this government's record $1.3 billion investment in the Solar Homes Program, Speaker. Last week, Speaker, I was absolutely delighted to announce that Victorians can now access the $3,500 solar homes battery rebate when they bundle their new rooftop solar with battery storage. This means customers no longer have to wait until they have solar panels installed before they can access the rebate for batteries. More than 4,000 Victorians, Speaker, have already taken up the battery rebate. And the member for South Barwon will be delighted to know that Torquay residents, for example, are racing ahead with battery rebates, as will the member for Ballarine, with Ocean Grove residents enjoying also their batteries in big numbers. And I'm sure that the members for Tarneit, Werribee, Bass will be delighted that residents in suburbs such as Hoppers Crossing, Wyndham Vale, Pakenham are also leaders of this pack, Speaker. The Solar Homes Program has already delivered 170,000 rebates, putting our power generation on your roof, Speaker, and batteries and solar hot water systems in the home. And, Speaker, by the time we finish, more than 770,000 Victorians will be absolutely delighted with these systems in their homes, saving them money, growing fantastic jobs. 5,500 jobs, Speaker, are being delivered through this program. Savings of about $1,000, Speaker, more than we had originally estimated, off power bills each and every year, Speaker, each and every year, and delivering greater safety through a very rigorous audit program, which is really important, which means that the standards of all solar installations will go up, and absolutely leading the way right across the nation. We've already abated about 820,000 tonnes of greenhouse gas emissions, Speaker, alone. And by the time we will finish, it'll be almost 4 million tonnes. This is about jobs, lower energy prices.
Minister's statement is concluded. It's the end of question time.